Okay, you can turn your Bible to Revelation chapter 9. Finally made it to chapter 9. This is kind of a bit more challenging than I had realized when I first got into this thing, you know, because it's like when you read Revelation, the book of Revelation, you want to think of the events that are happening, and it's hard to kind of shift it in your mind and say, what can we learn as Christians? Instruction and righteousness-wise. How can we apply what's written in Revelation to us as Christians today as challenges for our lives as Christians? It's an interesting challenge, but I like interesting challenges. But let's start out here. Verse 1, Revelation chapter 9, verse 1. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Okay, now, notice something here. The fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Why is the star called a him? You say, well, no, it was given to the angel that sounded. He didn't fall to the earth. The bottomless pit's on the earth. It's opened up down there. See, the fifth angel is sounding up in heaven. A star falls from heaven down to the earth, and to him is given the key to the bottomless pit. What's going on there? Well, this is a big study, and I'm not going to get into it right now, but there's definitely some scriptures that point to stars being angels. That's right. Job chapter 38. Turn your Bible to Job chapter 38. You can keep your finger there in Revelation chapter 9. Of course, you might have already pulled your finger out of that. You can turn back to it again. Not a big deal. But I want to show you a very strong verse that points to angels where they're actually called stars. Job chapter 38. It's beginning in verse 4. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. This is God speaking to Job here. Who hath laid the measures thereof, or if thou knowest, or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. See, in the context there of it, I believe that it's saying the morning stars singing and the sons of God shouting for joy. It's referring to the same group. Okay? I believe that that's what's going on there. And so, and it, you can go all through Scripture, and this is a, like I said, it's a big study. I got to get to it sometime. But over and over and over again, you see, you know, like when Jesus is born, the shepherds are out there, and they look up towards the stars, and all of a sudden the heavenly host is singing. You know, I think that there is, the fact of the matter is that the stars that are out there in the universe, the sun is not technically a star, according to Scripture. And again, I don't want to get into a whole big thing on this, but, you know, the sun and the moon are created of God. The stars are something separate. You say, well, yes, but science has proved that they're gaseous balls of you know, all sorts of chemicals and things that are burning and things like this. Science hasn't proved anything of the sort. Okay, they take a telescope and look at the sun, and they say, oh, look, although it's like on fire and everything else. And then they look and they say, all those other stars out there, those are also burning suns. Well, if you want to prove that to me scientifically, then you go there and you take some material, or you get some material from the thing or whatever else, and you bring it back and show it to me. All right. I don't believe it. I believe that the stars in the heavens are angels. I do. You say, well, that makes you look kind of stupid to modern science. Well, modern science teaches that everything came from nothing accidentally, and that we were once goo in a little pool, and we got zapped by lightning or some other thing, or perhaps aliens seeded us here. So, you know, that's modern science. So if they say you look foolish in their sight, well, they look foolish in my sight. So I'm not too worried about what they think about me. The Bible teaches, I believe, firmly believe, that the Bible teaches that angels are stars, and stars are angels. But turn back to Revelation chapter 22. I'll show you the greatest star of them all. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Isn't it interesting if you become a very wicked, vile person in Hollywood, they give you a star? Weird. And isn't it interesting that many countries put stars on their flags, including the modern nation of Israel, has a hexagram, a six-pointed star, and yet they're condemned in Scripture back in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, the book of Acts. Both places, it's said about that they have a star, Remphan, Chemosh, Moloch, different names to these false gods. Maybe they're not false gods. Maybe they're fallen angels. They're stars, represented as stars. But that's another study. A little bit too deep for this one right now. So back to Revelation chapter 9. It says here, and he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. Now, you know, again, you know, we read certain judgments in for the time of Jacob's trouble in the book of Revelation, and you go, wow, it's going to be bad. You know, the smoke comes up. Wow, it's really bad. But you don't think of the residual stuff, the things that happen as a result of that judgment. You know, a third of the trees being burned up. You know, we read about that. I guess it was, what was that, chapter 8, I think it was. You know, yeah, last chapter, chapter 8. You read about a third of the trees being burned up, and you go, man, that's really bad. You know, a third of the trees are gone. Yeah, but what about the smoke? And if the smoke, this smoke goes up and it darkens the sun and the air, what's that going to do to people? If you've ever been in a forest fire, it's kind of a bad situation. I mean, I have the video posted from a few years ago, right shortly after we moved here. I had an old three-wheeler and a thing caught on fire back in the wooded area and things, some of the land that we owned. And it caught on fire. There's nothing I could do. I didn't have a fire extinguisher. There's no creek nearby or whatever else. I had no choice. I was trying to battle the thing. I'm going around, you know, trying to stop out the fire from spreading. It created a small forest fire. And the smoke of that thing, I smelled like smoke. I was breathing this stuff in. It was terrible. Just from a little, maybe not even 30 feet in diameter burning. How about a third of the trees burning up? What kind of smoke is that going to create? And then this pit opens up and the sun and the air are darkened. It's going to be a bad time. It's going to be a very bad time. Verse 3. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. We'll come back to that in a minute. And to them it was given that they should kill them, or should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months, and their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses, prepared unto battle, and on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. Okay, we'll come back to this in a minute. But I want you to notice that unique wording here in verse 4, only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. So the only people that are protected from these horrible satanic locusts that are coming out, the only ones that are protected are the 144,000 sealed Jews. In other words, God does not say, hey, don't mess with the saints in the time of Jacob's trouble. You know why? Because it's a different situation. You see, there will be no Christians in the time of Jacob's trouble. Christians are people that are part of the body of Christ. These people, these saints in the time of Jacob's trouble, I mean, show me the word Christian in the anywhere for that time period, this time of Jacob's trouble, improperly called the Great Tribulation. Nobody is that's in that time period is in Christ. The eternal security is not there for these people. They have to endure to the end to be saved, Matthew chapter 24, verse 13. There is a sense of faith and works in that time period, and that's not heresy. It would be heresy if I was teaching it for today. It's not heresy when I say it's going to be that way out into the future. All right. It is going to happen like that. You can't take the mark of the beast. So God's not going to protect these people. Talk about a different relationship. Right now, God protects us. We are part of his body. All right. We're the body of Christ. You know, he's going to protect us from his judgments and plagues and things like this. I can't tell you how many times. I mean, there are so many stories of God protecting his people over and over again. Yes, the wicked sometimes will come and it will kill Christians and torture Christians and things like that, but it's not God doing that. These locusts, it's God opening, saying, hey, angel, go down there, open up the key to the bottomless pit, you know, or here's the key to the bottomless pit, open it up, and the locusts come up out. God's the one causing it. See, the whole book of Revelation, it's not God up there going, oh no, oh, the Illuminati and Harp is doing this terrible stuff. And you know, No. God is the one doing all of it. He's the one orchestrating this whole thing. Why? Because it's coming upon the lost world, the world that has rejected Jesus Christ. And it's so bad in that time that God actually looks down at saved people, saints in the time of Jacob's trouble, people that are there enduring to the end of to be saved. And the Lord says, no, I'm not even going to protect them from these locusts. It's a different setup. You say, why would God be so cruel to save people? Well, because they could be lost just like that. We can't be lost today. See, it's a different situation. They can walk away from the Lord at any time during that whole time. They can say, okay, you know what? I am sick and tired of this. I'm taking the mark. Okay? I'm going to worship the beast, take the mark. I'm just going to do whatever I have to do. All right? They've killed everybody that I know, and I haven't eaten anything in like a month, and I'm just like, I'm wasting away. I'm going to die, you know, here. And when I say I haven't eaten anything, you know, there's just been a few pieces of garbage or little scraps of food I eat just to survive, or eat some leaves off a tree or something like this. I'm tired of it. See? And that's going to happen in that time of Jacob's trouble. Absolutely, it will happen. And that's why so many of these false prophets that are teaching that the body of Christ goes into this time period, this time of Jacob's trouble, so many of them are saying, I don't think that there's any clear scripture saying you can't take the mark of the beast. And I don't see how God could make a rule where you couldn't be able to take it. I mean, you're going to have to provide for your own, don't you? You know, we have eternal security in the time period. See? That's why I'm so rough on these people that teach that the body of Christ goes into that time period. It's an absolute lie. God doesn't even deal with saved people. You know, people that are on that path of salvation there is what I'm saying. The only people that he protects are the 144,000 saved Jews. They're the only ones. It's really something to think about. Look at verse 7. I'm a little bit farther than I should have there first, but verse 7. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle. And on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. That would not be too much fun. The sting of a scorpion... Scorpion for 5 months it lasts. Doesn't go away for 5 months. Ouch. I remember that being down in Costa Rica, and it was like every night we stayed out in the jungle, and every night you had to do a bed check, critter check, you know, because they're just like these little cabins, and they didn't even have windows on, you know, like screens or anything like that. And of course, stuff could get in underneath the door. And occasionally, you know, you'd pick up your sleeping bag or whatever, and there'd be a scorpion over in there and stuff. You know, they were like small ones, little white ones. And, you know, they'd be there and stuff. And I remember seeing them, and never got stung by one. I'm glad I didn't. But I can't imagine them things flying. And they're probably not going to be this big. They're probably going to be a whole lot bigger and flying along and stinging you. I remember back right before I met my wife, when I was down in Pennsylvania, there was this stink bug infestation. And these stink bugs were just everywhere. I mean, it was insane. And you know, it was just like you'd go outside. I remember the one time two brothers came over and we were out target shooting up in the woods. You know, there was a little target range area with, you know, handguns and stuff, and we were up there target shooting. And you know, you're like aiming and stuff, and it's like these stink bugs are vroom, vroom, and landing on your head, and you land in your ear, and vroom, like this. And there was just swarms of them. And I remember, you know, the bad thing was if you go to swat them or whatever, they spray. And they spray this horribly disgusting smelling liquid, you know, and it's just, you know. And to this day, I don't have it up here with me, but my Ruckman Reference Bible, I was given it as a gift. And when we were moving, these stink bugs were getting into the house. I mean, they were finding any little crack or crevice that they could get into. And I remember when we were moving, the Ruckman Reference Bible was sitting on the desk like this, you know, the front cover sticks up a little bit. And I went like this and I grabbed the Bible and I heard, and I was like, what was that? I opened up, there's a squished stink bug right in the front of the Ruckman Reference Bible. I was like, oh man, you know, they're everywhere. I remember, tell you a little other story here. I'd be laying upstairs in the place I was, you know, living down there. And I'd be laying there and I had this air conditioner, window air conditioner, you know, and I'd be laying there and I'd hear, you know, I'd hear tung, 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 you know, these stink bugs getting sucked in through the vent, and then they're getting flapping away around inside the fan there, and then bling out into the room, and or bling, you know, getting chopped up. And then it'd be just like, okay, here we go. And then you'd smell the smell of the stink bug spraying as it's going into the air conditioner all night long, you know. Oh, it's terrible. So I've seen bug infestations, but I can't imagine what it'd be like to actually be in this time period and the bugs are coming after you to sting you. And they got tails like scorpions. And when they sting you, that pain lasts for 5 months. 5 months. And God's not going to protect any saved person in that time period, except for the 144,000 Jews that are sealed. You say, well, Brother Brian, I don't think that that's actually talking about actual locusts. I think it's talking about, I've seen people say it's talking about attack, you know, Apache helicopters or something like this. Okay. And stars are gaseous balls of matter out light years away that we know exactly what their consistency is too, right? Sure, I don't think so. No, I believe that they are stars or angels, and I believe these creatures are weird, mutant, I don't even know what. You know, stuff that's underground right now waiting to come up. All right. You say, well, I've not seen anything. Could you prove it scientifically today? No, I can't. It's not my responsibility. I'm a Christian. I'm going to be leaving before this time shows up. And so, you know, I'm just going through this thing and seeing what we can glean as Christians. But I'm not worried about these things. I'm leaving. And you're leaving if you're saved. If you're lost, well, then you're staying. And I don't think some, you know, what is it, DEET or whatever, you know, you spray to keep the mosquitoes off and things. I don't think that's going to keep these things away. Don't think so. Revelation chapter 9, verse 11 and 12. Let's look at this. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, or Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. Interesting that NASA uses the, you know, Apollo and Apollyon and stuff like this. They use a lot of the pagan god names and stuff like this for their different satellites and different things that they launch and whatever. Satanic organization, absolutely. Verse 12, one woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. All right. Now, another very interesting thing here. Who is this angel of the bottomless pit? I'm going to give you a little theory here on it in just a minute, but I want you to notice this thing here. They had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. So the Lord controls everything in this time period, but the Lord is also allowing the Antichrist to make war against the saints. We'll see that in a couple of weeks when we get to Revelation chapter 13. He gives him power and seat and great authority and things, you know, because he's giving that to the devil, and then the devil's allowed to give it to who he wants. See, the Lord he'll allow evil movements to rise up, and the Lord will protect you from that evil unless you start to forsake him and forsake his word. And everybody in the time of Jacob's trouble forsook the Lord. Every single person. Why? Because the saved people are leaving before the time starts. So the only people that are left behind are the ones that have rejected Jesus Christ. Something to think about there. But you see, this angel of the bottomless pit, he is the king of these locusts, these horrible, weird locusts that come up and they're going around stinging people. Who do you think he's going to send them after, primarily? Saved or lost? And when I say saved, I should, you know, it's I try to use, you know, our terminology for today. It's like they're not technically saved in the time of Jacob's trouble. They're being saved, you know, because they're having to endure to the end. So, but, you know, this angel of the bottomless pit, if he's the king of these locust creatures, he's going to be sending them after these people that are enduring to the end. It's going to be rough. I mean, let me tell you, it is going to be very, very rough. But who is this angel of the bottomless pit? Well, I'll show you the theory on that. John chapter 6. Turn your Bible to John chapter 6. John chapter 6, verse 70 and 71. Jesus answered them, "Have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil?" He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. Notice Jesus did not say, "One of you is possessed with a devil. One of you acts like a devil." He said, "One of you is a devil." That's one of those parts of scripture that you kind of look at and you go, well, if I take it for its literal meaning, then that means that there are literally devils that can walk around that look like men. He is a devil. Let's look at another part of this thing. Acts chapter 1. Turn one book over to towards the back of your Bible. The book of Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 24. Okay, it says here, "And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen, that he may take part of this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place." Judas committed suicide after he betrayed Jesus, after Jesus died on the cross there. He committed suicide. You read about that up in verse 18 of the same chapter. But it says he goes to his own place. Went to his own place there after he died. Could it be that he is the angel of the bottomless pit? Weird. Very, very, very strange stuff. And again, you know, a lot of the stuff I'm just showing you. Okay? You make up your own mind on this. You know, again, when you get into Bible-believing Christianity, you're going to see some weird stuff like this, where you read the Bible and you go, okay, that's really strange type of stuff. And you don't major on that stuff. Okay? This is not something and say, well, I'm going to dedicate my whole life to proving who are the devils out there. What are the devils that are walking around? The reptilians or something like this. I'm going to dedicate my life to proving that there are devils walking in the flesh to prove this verse. No. You know, and a lot of people get into this stuff. They'll get into the thing. I'll tell you another one. And, you know, get ready here. The flat earthers. You know, I am not saying that the earth is definitely 100%. I'm positive it's a sphere. It's definitely there. It's the earth is a flat. The whole thing's a I don't know. Okay. But to me, it's a divers and strange doctrine, and it's not going to profit me if I get involved in it. Right. If I start going around and preaching the gospel of the flat earth or something like this, I have other things to study, other things to do. I have plenty of work. All right. Those are not things that you major on. The gap theory. A lot of that stuff. It's extra stuff that's out there that the Bible's not super crystal clear on. You don't major on that stuff. You can have opinions between brethren. You can discuss these things and say, hey, what do you think? Who is Apollyon? Who's Abaddon there? You know, who do you think this is? You can discuss this. It could be that, this angel of the bottomless pit there, it could be he's somebody completely different. I have no idea. I really don't know. And again, I'm just not going to major on this stuff. I still get this thing, some of the brethren, you understand my position on the whole flat earth thing, and you say, well, he believes that the earth is a sphere. And, I have reasons for believing that. But I understand that there are some arguments that it's flat and things, and it's just like there's some good arguments either way. And I'm going, okay, fine. If I ever get all my work done and I have time to look at it, I'll look at it. But I'm just not going to major on that thing. All right? And you shouldn't either. Back to Revelation chapter 9. Revelation chapter 9, verse 13. We'll go down there. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. Now look at this. This is a very, very important verse. Extremely important. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men. Very important things there. First of all, let me make the point here. I find it very interesting. It says there that they're going to slay a third part of men. And the inauguration speech of Donald Trump, he actually said it in that speech. I'm not going to play any clips from it or anything here, but you can look it up, his inauguration speech. He actually says at one point, he said that we are going to, he said radical Islamic terrorism, that they're going to eradicate it off the face of the earth. Interesting, because you see radical Islam right now, Islam is radical. They're moderate Muslims. Yeah, well, that's because they don't follow the Quran, But Islam makes up about 23% of the world's population right now. All right. And you say, well, that's not a third though, brother. Well, I know that. But you see, there's bad things that could happen before the time of Jacob's trouble gets even started. I mean, there already is. There's huge tornadoes. I think 44 tornadoes just hit down in Mississippi the other day. I mean, there's flooding, there's fires, there's all kinds of things. There could be war, world war. That could take the population way down below 7 billion it is right now. Okay. That could take the number of Islam up above 23%. Up to a third. The Antichrist comes back and he goes out conquering and to conquer, takes peace from the earth. I'm just saying, it's a theory. I don't know. And I'm not saying Donald Trump is the Antichrist, okay? I don't believe that. I don't believe Donald Trump's the Antichrist. But when this Antichrist shows up, he's going to start a war to go out against a certain group. Islam would really fit the bill with the whole thing. And if they would wipe out Islam, that would be close to a third of the population. Very, very interesting. I find that to be kind of a unique thing. But let me show you something else here. Keep your finger there in Revelation chapter 9, but turn over to 2 Peter chapter 3. Second Peter chapter 3, verse 9. Here's one of the verses I think this is real great instruction in righteousness for a Christian today. Let's read it. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Why hasn't the rapture happened yet? I mean, it's just like, what on earth is he waiting for? I mean, good night. Everything is in place. I mean, it's just like the mark of the beast technology is there. It's like they got the whole world government, the world religion. Rome is taking over again. It's just like, and you're just going like, okay, the rapture has to be any minute now. I mean, come on here, Lord. What's going on? The Lord's not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. We look at it as carnal men, and we look and we say, what's he waiting? Is something wrong here? Stuff like this. He's not slack. Why? Our text in Revelation chapter 9 there, verse 15, these angels are prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year. Now, it would naturally follow that, you know, those angels are prepared for a specific time, then that means that the rapture would have to be for a specific time, you know. And I've been saying something. I got softly rebuked by a brother, and I appreciate it very much. He said, you got to quit saying if the Lord tarries. The Lord's not going to tarry, you know. The Lord's going to come back, and he's going to take his bride away in his perfect timing. What is his perfect timing? 2 Peter 3, verse 9, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. You know, a lot of people theorized that the rapture would happen in the year 2000, or maybe 1993, and then you have the seven-year time of Jacob's trouble, then 2000 starts the millennium. I'm glad it didn't happen then. Why? I wouldn't have made it. I wouldn't have made it in 2000. I wouldn't have made it, definitely wouldn't have made it in 1993. I wouldn't have made it. I would not have gone up. A lot of you out there, you've only been saved for a short amount of time. Aren't you glad the Lord has waited a little bit for the rapture? Yeah, absolutely. Why are we still here? Because his time has not happened yet. That time has not come. Now, we should be diligent about serving him and stuff, and you don't just say, well, then I don't have to, you know, witness or anything or try to pass out gospel tracts or anything like that because, you know, he's got it all figured out anyhow. So what good is, you know, what am I doing? Well, first of all, it's for rewards. But secondly, you're part of it. You're an ambassador of Jesus Christ. You know? And it, I mean, you were supposed to be witnessing. But watch out too. I need to say this because this has happened. You'll see this a lot of times. You know, they say, well, God's not willing that any should perish. And they'll stop there. Watch out for people that only quote that little part of the verse. Because it goes on to say, but that all should come to repentance. Not turn from unbelief to belief. Okay? No, all come to repentance. So, yeah, God's not willing that any should perish, but he wants people to repent. And like I said, it doesn't mean from turning from unbelief to belief. That's nonsense. But go back to Revelation chapter 9, verse 16. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000, and I heard the number of them. In other words, 200 million man army here. And thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire and of jacinth and brimstone, and the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions, and out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. By these three was the third part of men killed, by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone, which issued out of their mouths. For their power is in their mouth and in their tails, for their tails were like unto serpents, and had heads, and with them they do hurt. You say, well, see, those are obviously M1 Abrams tanks, and the tail on the back is probably a Ma Deuce, you know, 50 cal, whereas in the front you got the turret, you know, the big, you know, whatever, I don't know the caliber of the ones the M1s fire, but, you know, whatever the caliber is of the large artillery round, basically, that comes out of it. I'm screwing up the military talk, I'm sorry. You know, but, no, it's not what I'm talking about. Again, oh, well, the locusts are Apache helicopters and these horsemen are actually tanks. I don't believe that way. It's very ironic because actually my son and I were watching, I got online, I was looking at different things, and I saw this video and I was like, what is this? And I clicked on it, we watched it. Russia Today was reporting just today, I mean, here, was this Friday, I think it is. And just today, they showed a video of Russian military training in Siberia with dog sleds and reindeer pulling a sleigh with soldiers on it. You know, and people, and then they were on like snowmobiles too, and you know, these other tracked vehicles working, you know, through the snow and everything, and they're firing their AK-47s and stuff, these soldiers. And people would look at that and go, what a pathetic, backward military. No, not really. You see, animals, they don't break down. Yes, they can be shot and things, but you can feed them along the way. The military of the future, a lot of it is, if they're going to be successful, a lot of it's going to have to be going back to animals, old ways of warfare. A lot of this high technology stuff, I mean, you know, I've heard stories from people that have been over in, you know, Iraq and things, fighting over there, and it's just, it's so absurd. You know, again, my wife was over there, you know, when she was in the military before she got saved, and she told me stories of just ridiculous stuff. Soldiers messing around, you know, they get a little bit too much to drink, or they're just fooling around, and they, you know, a truck goes into some quicksand or goes off the road and rolls over, and they having to get all this heavy equipment in, and, you know, and it's like, you know, they're flying $250,000, well, probably more than that, you know, really expensive helicopters and these big heavy equipment and stuff and all this. That's wasteful. You spend so much money and things are breaking down all the time, stuff like that. You know, I mean, military vehicles are built very tough and everything else, but they break down. You need to refuel them. There's all kinds of problems. If you want to have some really effective troops, you put them on horseback. So don't tell me, well, this passage, it can't be talking about horses, a 200 million man army that's on horseback. I don't believe that. You know, it has to be tanks. No, it doesn't. And again, when you read the context of this thing, it's like, I can't show you stuff like this. Their tails are like the heads, you know, like on the serpents, and had heads, and with them they do hurt. I've never seen a horse like that. You say, well, then you can't believe it. No, I can believe it because it's written in this book. And again, these things are coming up out of the ground, these locusts. Could it be that the horses are coming up? Some kind of weird creatures and things like this? And you see some of these scientists, and they're doing all these weird DNA experiments and splicing genes and intermixing and cloning and all this other stuff. I'm just a dumb old hillbilly, you know. All I know how to do is just believe what I'm reading. I don't go to Greek. I don't go to Hebrew. I don't go and say, well, actually, it should be translated this. Nope. I'm so dumb, I just believe what I read. But that's just me, you know. Well, let's finish up here. Verse 20 and 21 in Revelation chapter 9. And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. A load of the Catholics out there that would worship these statues and things. And don't tell me, oh, we venerate them. We don't worship them. We venerate them. Yeah, okay. Verse 21. Neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their theft, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. Very interesting. Now, I do believe that there's a thing in this time of Jacob's trouble. When you take the mark of the beast and you worship the beast, there's a brand new situation there where you have somebody that can't get saved after they've done those things. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 through 11 talks about that. They're done. They're finished. Any man that worships the beast, takes the mark, you know, worships the beast and his image and takes the mark, they're finished. They're done. Okay. You can do some really wicked stuff right now in the church age and still get saved later on in your life. Time of Jacob's trouble, that's a different situation. And I really think when somebody takes the mark and they're worshiping the beast and his image, I think something changes up here mentally. And you have people that are so completely wicked, so completely evil, that they won't repent of anything. They can literally see God's hand moving on the earth and say, this is happening and that's happening. They can read the book of Revelation. It's coming to pass exactly as it's happening here, or as it's written here, and they can hate God. I think that's going to be the case there. But notice the word there in verse 21, nor of their sorceries. Now, sorceries and witchcraft is the same word in Greek, pharmakia. Pharmaceuticals are witchcraft. They are sorcery. And I wouldn't have believed that years ago until I started the research into these things, what these drugs are actually all about. They are based on alchemy. They are chemistry. There's nothing, you know, chemistry, of course, you say, well, chemistry's, let me explain, okay? Because chemistry is not a bad thing. But what I'm saying is, when you're taking chemistry and making it into pills for people to swallow from toxic ingredients that you know are going to make all sorts of horrible, terrible side effects with people, and they're not really going to cure anything, that's wicked, okay? No, chemistry is not bad, but when you use chemistry to poison people, then it becomes bad, right? Then it's a very bad thing. It's the people that are bad that are making it with that. Say it that way. But the pharmaceutical industry is a very, very wicked, it's the greatest drug dealing organization on the planet. And they actually do use drugs, by the way, too. They use heroin, they use things like that, opiates and things. With a lot of the headache medicine and a lot of painkillers and things like that are scientifically crafted and altered, you know, opium is what they are. Again, you know, proven fact. You can look that up. But these people in this time period, they don't repent. They refuse to turn from those wicked ways and say, hey, you know, God is real. And I think it's because they've taken the mark of the beast. But it's kind of ironic because in our world today, we're already starting to see this. I mean, how many times do you see a city just totally wiped out, and you'll see people occasionally and they're just like, wow, I just, you know, I'm thankful that God spared our lives, you know. And that just gives you really something to think about. Yeah, I lost everything, but, you know, God saved me and he saved my wife and my children, and I'm thankful for that. But then you see the other people and they're just like hard-hearted. They don't care anything at all about God. They get right back to doing their wickedness. You know, Hurricane Katrina came through a New Orleans area back there years and years ago, Louisiana there. And, wipes out New Orleans, and the Mardi Gras parade had to be canceled. And next year they had it again. They have these gay pride rallies and things like this. And God sends judgment. And they just say, okay, we'll do it next weekend. Wicked. Wicked people. I really think that a lot of the people that we are seeing out the grocery stores and seeing out there, the coworkers and people that we see out in public, it vexes us so bad. You're looking at people that are going to be taking that mark of the beast. Their minds are already moving in that direction. But there's still a few that are going to get saved. And I'm going to try to kind of redo my speech and say, and not say if the Lord tarries anymore. The Lord has it planned out, brethren. He's not slack concerning his promise. He's taking us out of here. Okay? So that is going to be it for Revelation chapter 9. Going to be doing chapter 10 here next. And like I said, it's kind of an interesting study. But trying to get some other work done along with this. I don't want to just go week after week after week with this expository study, this kind of exhortation study, maybe would be a better way to say it. There's just a lot of other projects I want to get done. But just really do appreciate everybody's prayers. Again, thank you to everybody that donates to the ministry. I always want to, you know, I try to say that, you know, periodically and things. We do appreciate that. Really do need your prayers. Just kind of working on some things right now, but not going to get into a lot of that. But I guess that's it for this study. And we will see you in the next study, whether it's Revelation chapter 10, or I know that there's a couple other videos I might be coming out with first. But that is going to be it. We will see you in the next video.